Your students are most likely on Twitter. So it's something that we need to get into. It's something that may not be ordinary for you, it may not be regular, but get in the habit of checking your Twitter feed. If you come across some type of leadership principle or some kind of life lesson, tweet it, because people really do read it. Your students, if you start tweeting, your students will read those tweets. The difference in Facebook and Twitter is that there's a lot less communication, like two-way communication happening on Twitter. A lot of what Twitter is just someone's heart coming out. And so it's not like a conversation as much as Facebook is, because you don't comment. You express what you're feeling. And so you can see how this would be powerful for us as leaders to look into the lives of our students. Whereas they won't say something in Life Group, they will say it on Twitter. They may be talking about your Life Group on Twitter. And so if you're not on it, then you're not going to see what's going on in their hearts. So I would encourage you to go ahead and follow your students. It's fine to follow them. Don't reply to their tweets, because they don't want you to. You can reply to it, but they don't want you to. You can retweet what they say, because they feel more approved in what they say when you retweet it, something positive, or you favorite it. And so you can affirm the positive things they say, but you can also see the negative thoughts that they have. It's coming out in word form, and then you can talk to them one-on-one.
So I send a text to 40404.
Yeah.
In the bottom of it.
Yeah. And then
that's my recipient, 40404?
That's the number that you
send. That's the number you got.
Yeah.
So to the number 40404,
okay.
And then write out this message. Follow.
Capital F.
With a capital F,
okay.
And then leave a space.
Okay.
Put the at sign. Walk your cross.
Do I have to capitalize anything?
No.
Yeah. And no spaces in any of that.
No spaces, no nothing.
Okay.
And then you'll receive something that says you're now following Walk Your Cross, and then you'll receive our latest tweet.
That's really good.
Almost 3 years ago, I was playing with Evan, who was almost 2 years old at that time. He was still one. It's hard to believe. But we were playing with Play-Doh on the ground, and I felt this strange pain in my side. I thought, well, you know, I must have just overdone it or, you know, something. But I decided, all right, Evan, let's move to the table. So we played with Play-Doh on the table. As the evening went on, the pain got worse. Worse and worse. And I put Evan to bed that evening, and the pain was really, really bad. I told Candace, I don't know what's going on. It's been getting worse. I think I need to go to the hospital. Well, you're going to have to drive yourself,
because I don't like people.
I love my wife. I really do. And then by 11 o'clock, we were getting ready to go to bed, and I knew something was wrong. Something is not right. That's mild compared to how I was really acting. I was close to tears. I knew something was wrong. And I didn't know what it was. And so she said, I think you need to call Dr. Bruce. It's 11 o'clock. She said, well, I think you need to call him. So I felt horrible, but I gave him a call, and he's told us that we can call him anytime. He gave us, you know, the staff at the church, his cell phone number, and he said, anytime, just give me a call. And so I did. And he said, John, it sounds serious. You need to go to the emergency room. So I did. When I got there, they did some tests, and they determined that it was my gallbladder. And my gallbladder was failing. And I had sizable gallstones in my gallbladder. And one of the gallstones was blocking my bile duct. So it was quite serious, and so I had to have emergency surgery. And when I came out, they told me that my gallbladder was four times its normal size, and it had gangrene on it. They couldn't see any of the gallstones because they were all inside. But he said it was bad. He said had you waited, you could have gone septic and died. He said had it been 100 years ago, you would have died. It's like, wow, you're a great doctor. but that told me. I wonder what's the worst pain that you have ever experienced? Just like here we go. All right. Let's keep our answers, because there's a lot of us. Let's keep our answers to like 30 seconds or so. There's a technique. See there? But childbirth. What else?
Meningitis.
Okay.
Spinal meningitis. I had a spinal tap.
Oh.
I had a spinal headache from childbirth that was like that.
Kidney stones.
I've never had kidney stones. No, great.
Brought me to my knees. Literally.
Oh. Appendectomy.
Watching Eric kick Steve in the shins is one of the worst pain ever.
Time and time again. The third time it was numb. So.
What I've learned lately, and I read this in a book, is that pain is important because it leads to action. Dr. Paul Brand worked for many years among lepers in India, and he discovered that the main problem with lepers is that they feel no pain, and so they're always injuring themselves. See, pain is, in a way, God's gift to the human body. And in the same way, guilt is a form of mental and emotional pain. We feel guilt when we do something that we know that we shouldn't do, right? Or we don't do something that we know that we should do. All of us have felt the guilt that comes with that. Before the fall of man, there was no guilt. It was a perfect society, a perfect community with no guilt and no pain. But with the fall, God instituted guilt and he instituted pain. And so pain is a physical warning sign from your body. And guilt is a spiritual and emotional warning sign from your heart. Charles Starkweather, I don't know if any of you recognize that name, he went on a shooting spree in the 1950s, and he killed 14 people. And I know there have been plenty of people from the 1950s until now who have done even worse things than that. 14 people doesn't seem really like that many people. But when he was talked to afterwards, someone asked if he felt guilty for what he did. And he said, nah, it was just like shooting rabbits. Can you imagine that type of mentality? Like, this guy is like a spiritual leper, you know? He's unable to feel any type of emotional or spiritual pain. And whether it's because of his past, his childhood, whatever it may be, there may be all kinds of triggers. He's gotten to the point to where he's numb to spiritual guilt. It's like he's a spiritual leper. Now, that's an extreme case, but we've got to help our students to build a moral compass in their lives. And obviously, they know right and wrong. But do they have a biblical worldview when it comes to their moral compass? Proverbs 4:23 is in your notes. It says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. The New American Standard Bible says, watch over your heart. I like that. Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flows the springs of life. Our students have got to learn to guard their heart. And that becomes increasingly hard in this era. You know, this year alone, the average middle school student will spend over 200 hours studying math in school. Okay? Seems like a lot. 200 hours studying math in school. Now, they will spend 300 hours watching TV or movies. 300 hours. They'll spend 600 hours using their mobile phones in 1 year. So what are they getting from that? Are they guarding their hearts? We've only got 40 hours at most with our students. So how are we going to utilize that time that we have? In our world, right now, alcohol abuse begins as early as 10 years old. Just let that sink in for a moment. That's less than a sixth grade student. And that's when alcohol abuse begins. The average age to view pornography is 11 years old, sixth grade. 12-year-olds are prone to self-harm. Suicide is the third leading cause of death among adolescents. We live in a tough culture. Counselors are reporting a rapidly growing epidemic of depression among teens, where they gain acceptance and they gain their value from pictures that they post on the internet or videos and whether or not they get likes or the comments that they get. I see all the time the comments that these students are getting on their pictures, that students are just knocking them down over and over again. And it's bullying, but it's accepted. And it's really encouraged, and it's seen as funny. But it's knocking these students down over and over and over again. So how are we going to react? Our reaction should be love. You know? Love is a leading fruit of the Spirit. It's the focus of the Great Commandment, and it's this distinguishing characteristic of Christians. That's what all the Bible says that love is. And it's our student ministry tagline. Our new tagline is "Everyone Matters." So the way that we have formed this is by saying "every," and then the number one, and the word "matters." Everyone matters, and it's centering around everything that we do, focusing on every single student, whether they're rich, whether they're poor, whether they're socially accepted or socially reject. That's why we have come up with so many ways for so many events that we do to be free, because we want to include everyone and help them realize that they matter to us because they matter to God. See, leaders touch a heart before they ask for a hand. That's the theme of this session that we're on. Leaders touch a heart before they ask for a hand. That's a principle that I found in John Maxwell's 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership, which is an excellent book. If you haven't read that, I would highly recommend that. It's in the resources page there on the last page before the schedule. But leaders touch a heart before they ask for a hand. God has entrusted us to have access into these children's lives. Reggie Joyner says, it's just a phase. It's just a phase. So don't miss it. So how are we going to lead? Just a few quotes that I want to leave with you. St. Francis of Assisi said, seek first to understand, and then to be understood. How can we apply that principle to our leadership in our life group? Seek first to understand and then to be understood. Solomon said, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. And Jesus said, let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. Let's pray together. God, as we enter this last session, I pray that you would speak through us and give us principles that we need to know for leadership, whether it be within our life group, whether it be home or in our business. God, I pray that you would build us up in leadership in a way that transforms lives. That we would become the Christian men and women that you want us to become. At home, as fathers and mothers, as wives and husbands, at work, as positional leaders, and especially within your church's context, as leaders, as elders, as deacons, as life group leaders. God, I pray that you would empower us in a profound way that can only come from you, and that we would lead with excellence. Those who follow us would see you through our example and through you reflecting in our lives. We love you, and we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Let's watch this video. Remember, no crying.
Suggest to you is the one you're working with now, especially as life members, the one you're working with right now. that is the most significant phase of that student's life. You need to be specialists in your age group. Stay focused on what that student needs in that phase. But like I said, there's three, a follow-up to that great answer of which stage is most important. I believe it's the phase that happens directly before and directly after your current age group, which is why we want to do all this together instead of separating you guys out in middle school and high school. It's important for us to all know all the phases because transitions can be rough from phase to phase. They can be really rough, and we need to help guide them. So we need to know where they're coming from and where they're going. Because you have late bloomers. You have people, students that are going to be ahead of the curve. They're growing up faster than others just because of life circumstances, just because of their background. We want to take advantage of any groundwork that's been invested up to this point. The time we have is now to mold them for what's next. And like I said, we don't have all the answers. But any chance we get to help the student and parent understand what's going on in their crazy world is an opportunity to deepen our relationship with them, but more importantly, deepen their relationship with Christ. We unfortunately missed the opportunity. Joyner talks about this in his Facebook, that the toddlers are embracing. It's a physical affirmation. And we can do that with appropriateness, this, you know, side hug. High five, fist bump. But we don't get to hold them in our laps. We miss that phase as junior high and senior high life makers. We've really missed the phase of grade school where you engage imaginations. Space is not too far of a reach. It's at their fingertips. And you really get to engage their minds. But we have the awesome opportunity and responsibility to affirm them in middle school and mobilize them in high school. And it's an important step. And so we just wanted to encourage you that you've signed up to be a significant relationship in the life of a student. And possibly some even that are outside of your group. That's God gives you opportunities. I found this was interesting. The average educator spends over 5,000 hours studying childhood development before they try to teach a class. That's a lot of homework. A typical pediatrician will spend 10 years and nearly $500,000 so they can practice medicine with children. It's a big investment. The manufacturer of the top-selling toy, Barbie, still, will spend an estimated $600 million per year to win the heart of a typical 8-year-old girl. It's a lot. The point is, sometimes it takes a lot of time, effort, resources, if you want to have influence with students. It's true for teachers who want to help kids learn. It's true for doctors who want to help kids be healthy. It's true for toy makers who want to help kids play. It's true for any church that wants to help kids grow in a relationship with God. You have to make an ongoing, continuous investment learning about kids if you hope to have a consistent influence with kids. And that's why you guys are here today. So preach it to the choir. But just imagine taking a toddler to a YouTube concert, or taking a middle schooler to a Yo Gabba Gabba event, or a third grade boy to a Barry Manilow concert. Right? Probably not the best ideas. Our struggle is that God does not change. We know that. God is constant. And God is good. He does not change. But the way a student views God is supposed to change. The way we view God is supposed to change. It's like a diamond. And each turn, it gets more beautiful. We see a new color. We see a new facet. It's awesome. It's a journey. So our job at every phase, our job is not to redefine God for them. God is God. But it's our job is to help kids rediscover who God is at every phase. We need to learn about the phases or stages of growing up. We should know what's changing in their physical world, in their mental world, in their relational world, in their cultural world, in their emotional world, and in their moral world. There's not a hard and fast rule for every student. We can't say this is the cookie cutter approach to doing life group. We can't say this is how you've got to do it. That's just not going to work because each student is different and each group is different. Each group is unique. There is no other 8th grade girls life group like our 8th grade girls life group right now. There's no other group like it. And that's same true for all of your groups. And so the generations help us not get so frustrated because we can relate with some, we don't relate with others. But when our 7th grade girl makes a profoundly deep spiritual comment or question one moment, and then the next moment is posting a TBH on Instagram, which is a to be honest, if you don't know what those are, students will put those out and they say TBH. And people like them and they are incredibly honest with each other. Like, I know you from school, I really don't like you. To be honest, TBH. TBH, you're my best friend. We grew up together. We love each other. We're like sisters. Yay. Heart, 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 smile, face, kiss, focus. That's where they're at. And so they're doing that one moment, and then the next moment they're asking about heaven and hell. And you're like, what is going on with this student? How, I mean, we are polar opposites, like very carnal, flesh-driven TBH to a very spiritual, deep, maturing Christian. What's going on? It's just a phase. They're growing, and it's okay. But we don't want to miss these phases. Like John said, I'm going to cover a lot of what we've already said because this is kind of our summary. It's kind of a, what's the point of all this? Why are we talking about phases? But St. Francis said, seek first to understand and then to be understood. That hit me and John between the eyes. It's just our nature to want to be understood. We want to be understood. We want people to understand us. And St. Francis was very wise when he said, we need to seek first to understand. Because only when we understand them, do they have a chance to understand us. We naturally overestimate students' capacity. The danger, this is really good stuff, the danger of expecting them to do more than they are capable of leads students to becoming discouraged and eventually giving up. However, when activities are too simple and not challenging enough, students get bored and disinterested. So we've got to play in that tension. Not too much, not too little. Know what can be expected of them. Know how they think, how they will hear what you're saying, how they will listen to what you're saying. And don't forget some of the stuff we talked about today, because there's present realities that are distinctive for each phase, for each group. Some of us are better specialists, focusing on the age group we're with. And that's okay. You see the tree with its distinctive branches and its leaves and the separations from the other trees. And you see the separations of phases. That's good. Some of us in this room are better generalists. We see the forest. We see all the phases working together as one story to bring a child, student to Christ. We see the similarities. We see the connectedness. I'm more of a generalist. That's where I naturally fall. But all of us can get better at both. And that's our challenge. Another challenge is to reactivate parents every year. This is something we're working on as a student ministry. I think we're really good at sixth grade orientation, getting the parents on board and downloading a bunch of information and getting them. But when the seventh grade year rolls around, and the eighth grade year, and the freshman year, we start to lose, I think, some of our contact with parents. So you guys become the front lines. And so please, please, please reactivate and stay in touch with your parents. It's very important. Here's why. No one knows your student better than their parent. No one. Maybe God. Definitely God. But as we said, phases are generalizations, and parents know their students' patterns, they know their students' tendencies, they know their history, they know their preferences, They know their child's behavior better than anyone. But it's important, life group's important. I mean, well, you could say, well, let's just let the parents raise these kids and we'll support the parents. Well, that's one strategy. Why we do life group is because life group leaders know something that parents don't. We work with multiple kids in the same general phase every week. And so we can help parents understand that you're not alone. Your kid's struggling with this. I've seen this in other students. You're not alone in this thing. If a behavior is normal or abnormal, a life group leader can step in and be like, I know your kid has this tendency. It's really not normal. And we need to work through how we can help. Or we can say, that's totally normal. Don't worry that they're doing this. It's totally normal, which is a great encouragement and affirmation for parents. They may need to adjust their parenting skills according to a new phase, and you're able to help them do that.
If something is abnormal, do you want us to address it, or do you guys want to address it?
So, when it comes to abnormalness, and even conflict, John and I think, I can speak for John, we would prefer you guys try to handle with the parent. You guys have that frontline responsibility, and we trust you guys to do that. Now, if you want counsel or advice, we're here for you. If it gets to the point where you need to call us in, we are more than happy to help.
Do you prefer to always be in the loop, please?
We like to be in the loop. We're going to talk about that at the very, very end. We're going to talk about communication with us and how that looks.
Hey, Jim, it's just pretty easy.
You say, hey,
there's something wrong with this kid.
Yeah. But yeah, you got to be smart. You got to be gentle. You got to be loving about it. But you have group dynamics, and you've got to protect the group dynamic while also loving the individuals. And so it's tough. It's tough to lead a small group. It is not for the weak-hearted. We've got to adapt. We've got to be continually adapting to what phase they're at and what phase they're going to be at next. Kodak and Blockbuster. Kodak and Blockbuster, those are two great companies for you to think of. They did not adjust. They said, digital media is a fad, and it's not going to last. Disney World and Amazon adjusted, and they took over. And Kodak and Blockbuster, I don't even know where the closest Blockbuster to us is now. You guys remember Blockbuster video rooms, right? I don't know where the closest one is. There's some family videos I know of in Greenwood, but they're dwindling too. And Kodak, I mean, that's the biggest example to me. Kodak was huge in photography and all that stuff, which seemed natural to fit. They should have had the corner with Instagram, but they didn't adjust. And so it's a great example for us as leaders. We've got to continually adjust. There's no one set way that we can say, okay, we're digging our heels in, and this is the way it's going to be forever. Because we can miss a whole generation if we do that. Communicate with parents. Not only what we're doing with our events, but also affirm and help them understand what their students are going through. Email, Facebook, and text are the best way we found to communicate with parents, other than face-to-face while they're picking their students up for those that don't drive. And so encourage your parents. Commiserate with them. It's not outside of your scope to get the parents together without the students and just have a time of fellowship.
One thing that some of us in practice, like when we go watch the kids in sports, sit with the parents.
Absolutely.
We like to do that. It's always fun. They appreciate that. But
that's a great way. And, I mean, you're supporting their student, which they appreciate you doing.
Now, will you repeat that for the camera?
Yeah, Laban just said that when we go to sporting events or a concert or something, that we need to sit with the parents or the families that we know that are there. And we'll sit by yourself and sit in the back row. That's all right, but it's much more effective if we make the connections while we're there. Every phase, no matter if it's 6th grade or 12th grade or 13th grade, every phase needs a consistent leader and a unique response. Celebrate milestones. For those of you who don't know what milestones are, burgers for baptisms. Do donuts for new drivers. Do tacos for making it to your teens, okay? That 13th birthday is a big deal. I was having trouble with G's for graduates, so I said gondola rides for graduates. I don't know. But seriously, celebrate those moments in their life. National Honor Society, even Honor Roll, whatever it is. Their team's in the state championship. By all means, celebrate together. I don't think we celebrate enough as a church. We have the most things to celebrate through Christ. And we need to do it. Now, there's a caution here. Don't make every day a celebration, right? Hallmark's done that, right? It was National Buffalo Wild Wing Day last week, I think, or 2 weeks ago. We don't need a day for everything. You don't need a day for their first, first homework completed assignment. That's not a milestone. Try to pick out the big events. And they get more than food. I was being goofy. Well, gondola rides weren't food, but the rest of them were food. But talk about the significance at those events when you're celebrating a baptism or celebrating a driver's license. Talk to them about what's appropriate, especially for a new driver. With freedom comes great responsibility, right? With great power comes great responsibility. Talk about those kind of things. Here's another thing we want you guys to realize. It's not your job to teach everything in the Bible to your student in 7 years. It's not possible, actually. Even Jesus, God in the flesh, came. He did not teach the entire Bible to his disciples. In fact, when he was cornered, he prioritized it to two things. Love God, love others. I think we'd be wise to do the same. We don't need to be taking our 6th or 7th or 8th graders through Joel or through the reign of Hezekiah, okay? This stuff is important. All scripture is God-breathed. Hear me on this, okay? All scripture is God-breathed and useful for correcting, teaching, and training. But not all teaching is applicable to every phase. We've got to be discerning. We've got to know what stories are going to connect with our students so they see God. We've got to connect with them. The foundation of their faith should be relationships, not information. I think the church has missed this. We tried to make the whole generation's foundation on information. We had Sunday schools. We had Bible study. We had all these things where kids would have their minds. I know friends of mine who had more Bible knowledge than I have. And they are not in a healthy relationship with Christ. Relationship is the foundation, not the information. Now, the information has to be good, and it has to be from the Bible. But hopefully you're understanding and discerning on that. We have a limited time. We want every phase, at every phase, we want every student to know that they matter, like John said. Individually, together, to each other, to us. Most importantly, we want these students to know they matter to God. John, Becky, and I are always here for you guys. We feel like our job is to equip you to do the ministry. And so if you need something, if you have a question, if you want to talk, just hang out. I like to eat, and I have a church card, so we can go eat. But seriously, we are here for you guys, and we want our influence to be with you guys, because we believe that's how we're going to reach and multiply. So please, have our numbers and get a hold of us when we need us. You guys are the youth ministers. And unfortunately, John and I may get a lot of the credit, but we shouldn't, because Becky should get it before us. And then after Becky, it should be you guys, because you guys really are the youth ministers. Thank you guys for loving God and for loving our students. John's going to come up and talk about our last full session.
At the end of our time together, we're going to do a little bit of Q&A. We're going to go a little bit long here, but not very long. I think the departure time says 3:15. We might do 3:30. We might depart at 3:30. What's the matter with this thing? We're talking about we've done here, we've done C, now we're doing touch. What Matt has really described as touch, it's touching the hearts of your students and touching the hearts of their parents, which is paramount, doing something that Matt and I can't do by ourselves, because we have a lot of students in our student ministry, and as you know, we create these life groups so that our big student ministry feels very small and very intimate. And so, like Matt said, you all are on the front lines, you're in the trenches, and you're touching the students' lives and making connections with parents that we can never make. But there's a problem here. There's a tension that comes about. And that is that you, even alone, have a lot of hearts to touch. I think the smallest group in here is about 5. I think the largest group in here is about 25. And so you've got a lot of hearts to touch. So how can you touch everyone's heart? The answer is that it begins with creating a safe place. And that's what we're going to be talking about, creating a safe place. Everyone in your group is different. You know, some people like hip hop, other people like rock. You know, some people like pizza. Other people don't seem to eat any food whatsoever. So how do you touch the hearts of everyone in your group? I want to talk about leadership that touches hearts. Every year a child gets older, trust and respect gets harder and harder to earn. And if you've had kids, then you realize that. It's harder and harder, all the way up until graduation. And you've got to earn that respect, that trust. And it's up to you to lead in a way that establishes trust. We had to really think hard, and we had to be very prayerful about how to replace Christy in a proper way in the senior group. And so we believe that Stephanie, as I've already mentioned, would be the perfect person because of how she can establish trust with a group, and she's already connected with so many people in this group, and she's going to do the same thing in the seniors group. And I hope that you are the same way. I hope that even if you've been with your students throughout this whole process, that you'll step in and you'll establish trust with them right away. We need to lead our group to value acceptance. That's the first fill in there. Lead your group to value acceptance. Acceptance is the best way to grow a group, but it has to be learned. It has to be taught. Kids don't naturally accept people who are different. Now, kids do naturally accept people, right? And especially the younger they are, the more natural it is for them to accept people. But they accept people who are similar to them. But we've got to be constantly teaching that value of acceptance. Acceptance is also the best way to share as a group. If you expect someone in your group to share openly with you, then there has to be a value of acceptance within your group. They won't share if they don't feel comfortable. They won't share if they don't feel accepted. And acceptance, as you know, can be broken in an instant with a simple eye roll by you or by someone else in the group, by a knowing stare to the other leader. You know, that you and the leader know exactly what that look is. But so do the students. So we've got to be very careful what we do. Heavy sigh. When that person speaks up again, a knowing smile, like, we know what you do, you know. The way you handle relational tension sets a tone. here are ways to gain respect from everyone. We have to be happy to see everyone in our group, even if we're not happy to see certain people. We can all think of certain people who we're thinking, man, if that person just wouldn't come, our group would go a lot better. You know, we've got to be genuinely happy to see everyone. We don't know what happens at home. You know, we don't know the conflict that takes place in that person's life. So be happy to see everyone and give eye contact to everyone. Don't bypass certain people. Get on their level. This is hard for me to get on their level, and it's hard for Jen too, because we're like 8 feet tall. So like during summer life group, some of you guys came, Eric came, some other people came to summer life group, and they always wanted to sit on the floor, man. So like it hurts my back, legs to sit on the floor. It's rough, man. But we need to stretch ourselves and get on the floor and get on their level. We need to lean in to what they're saying and truly listen. We need to celebrate everyone equally. We need to shut down gossip. Whether you're a guy's group or a girl's group, we've all got gossip in our groups. And it can plague the value of acceptance within a group. We've got to shut that type of thing down. In the same way, we've got to shut down bullying. We see that take place, we've got to stop it, whatever it means. Even if it means talking to the parents, even if it means dismissing a student for a week or whatever it may mean, got to shut that down. We've got to privately address individual issues as they rise. Matt already spoke about that, so I don't need to talk more about that. And those are ways that we, as life group leaders, can value acceptance. So value acceptance, and then number two, lead your group to value confidentiality. Confidentiality is hard for a lot of reasons, because confidentiality can be forgotten until it's breached, right? You don't think much about confidentiality until someone breaks a code that we thought that we had set up, you know? But then the person goes and they Mark tells the whole football team about Jake's bed wedding, right? Or Tiffany has tweeted about Robin's disgusting foot fungus, right? These are just examples. Ryan has shown the whole class pictures of Justin's blankie, right? I mean, these things happen. And then what do you do? What do you do when things like that happen? You know, you have to go on the defensive. You know, when what we should do is be proactive about those types of things. So it's tough. Confidentiality is tough. And it's also tough because there's a gray line as to where confidentiality begins and where it ends. Where do you draw that line? Do we know when to keep something confidential and when to tell somebody? When to talk to the parents and when not to talk to the parents? How do you know how to designate that gray line? And many of you already know that you need to go off of the four hurts. And you probably know this, but just go ahead and write it down anyway. It's a good review for all of us. The four hurts that end confidentiality. Any of these four things happen, confidentiality is over. And your students need to know this. If they are hurting themselves, even if it's cutting, we need to make somebody aware. Whether it's us or whether it's parent, you need to make somebody aware. Whether it's hurting others, if they're hurting other people, even if it's not extreme, but they're hurting people emotionally, physically, whatever it may be, we need to tell somebody. So, hurting themselves, hurting others, and then being hurt. If they're being hurt by somebody else, a parent, teacher, boyfriend, girlfriend, friend, anyone, we need to know. And usually it's the three hertz, the three H's. The three H's, right? That's what we normally think of, but I added one more that ends confidentiality, and that is having sex. If somebody is having sex, and they let you know that, then you've got to tell somebody. Whether it's us, Matt, or myself, or it's the parent. That's where confidentiality ends. And if something is borderline, then just go ahead and let us know. No.
What was the third one?
The third one is being hurt. So, hurting themselves, hurting others, or being hurt, or having sex. Those are the four H's that end confidentiality. So we need to honor confidentiality, and we need to make sure that others in the group understand confidentiality, that what's said in the group stays in the group. It can be your Las Vegas rule. Okay, that's fine. But they need to also understand where confidentiality is. Lead your group to value that.
Would it be okay to make like something written up?
Yeah, absolutely. Do a code of conduct.
I've been in life groups at another church where they had done that, in a life group where they had a contract. And you read through the confidentiality and you signed it.
Here's what we did back in the day when our kids were freshmen, way back in the day. We actually made out, we had them make the rules. I think Marty led that up, had them make the rules. And we helped them come up with the rules. Like we said, all right, confidentiality is good, but let's say, for example, that someone's hurting themselves. Shouldn't we let them know? Shouldn't we let someone know? Oh, yeah, yeah. So, you know. So, like, maybe have them write the rules, like I mentioned before, but make suggestions, you know, kind of persuade them in a certain way, you know? Be manipulative.
Yes,
sir.
What's
up, Eric?
This is an interesting exercise to go through. I do recommend that what you talked about, making rules, and it'll be interesting how it's received, because depending on the age, being middle school, like I heard you comment, like in 10th grade, let them make the rules, because they're starting to realize who they are and starting to realize what they stand for, so it's a great time to empower them. Yeah. 2 years ago, we made rules for our group, and they totally rejected every one of them, up and down the line. Stuff that they made and signed to. But I just kind of think about, kind of in the age groups that we talked about, how sometimes that won't be met with what you think it might be met with.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean don't do it. It just kind of means be aware.
It may happen anyway.
Yeah, be aware of it and be ready to kind of continue to move with it or stand for it, kind of thing, but keep moving forward.
Yep, move forward. And we've got to value confidentiality.
I don't think we really even emphasized that last year. Like, this is confidential. We stay here.
Yeah, and that's the thing, and that's what I'm saying, is that a lot of times we don't even think about confidentiality until it's breached.
Yeah.
So we've got to be careful of that. Mm-hmm. Marty?
Just to Eric's point, sometimes you may not live up to those rules all the time, but going back to the beginning, it's a great place to really dial in and listen. Watch their body language.
Yeah, watch.
You'll find out a lot about the people in your group when you start discussing rules.
Yeah,
yeah. And you know how sometimes you can teach a lesson within a lesson.
Yeah.
And so someone breaches confidentiality, and we teach grace. We go off in a different direction, and the Holy Spirit leads us to talk about something totally different. So feel...
Be ready for the impact to be something different than the obvious.
Yeah, be ready for that. Be ready for that. Great comments.
I have a question.
Yes.
The being hurt, and you talked about emotional. So if we're going to follow the kids on Instagram, the people who comment on Instagram are people that they have said can follow them, right? Do you have to accept a follower?
Yes. If there is a setting, so the question was on Instagram, as far as emotionally being hurt, does that apply, and do you have to accept people on Instagram? You have to, some settings, some people have it set up to where you have to accept that friend. So they can click follow, but then you have to accept that person's follow. Some people just leave it open. I leave it open to anyone, because what I'm putting out isn't critical, and I don't care who follows me. But some people are much more choosy than that, and that's fine.
But it's possible that the people that are hurting them are people that they sent.
Yeah. And you can block that person. They can block you from Instagram and stuff like that.
That would be something. That would just be something to talk to them about, right?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So we need to think. We need to think along the lines of not just verbal, but technological abuse as well, like cyberbullying and things like that. That's great. We need to be very aware of that. So again, don't have an Instagram, get one. Anything else before we move on? We need to value, lead your group to value honesty. Honesty. This starts with you, so lead the way. Be transparent with your group. Know how to filter details, but be honest with your group about your life. Know when to share certain things and when not to share certain things. And as an adult, you're not going to want to talk about everything with a student. But just be open and be honest and be transparent. They will appreciate that, and that will help them to be honest then with you. Show them that you're not perfect. They view you on a pedestal, whether you want them to or not, whether you realize it or not. So be honest with them. It shows them that you care. We've all heard the saying, they won't care what you know until they know that you care. But that actually is quite true. So we need to encourage them to be transparent, but we need to lead the way in that transparency. And it could be healing for you too, to share with a group what you have been through. Maybe you have never done that before. Maybe this is a great chance for you to grow spiritually as well. So encourage them to be transparent with you. And they will. This is the last thing I'm going to say. They will be transparent with you. Because of the way that we have life groups set up, sixth grade leaders turn into seventh grade leaders, turn into eighth grade leaders who aren't here. That's okay. They'll get the video. Turn into ninth grade leaders, and they follow them all the way through. And so by the time your few are, by the time you're sitting up in this area and then moving on, your few will be sharing with you in ways that are profound. And you will get to know them in ways that you never thought possible. So they will be themselves. They'll ask questions such as, what if I was born gay? So be ready. Be ready for that. Know how to answer that. They'll ask questions. They'll share their doubts. What if hell isn't real? What if this whole thing is a myth? Matt said already, did God really create the world in 6 days and then take a rest on the seventh? Why did he need a rest? So be ready for those questions.
So John, you had mentioned that parents, there's something that you mentioned about parents and that you necessarily don't want to teach, maybe that's not the word, you don't want to do something different than a parent. They do. What was the context for that?
Say that again.
You had mentioned earlier that there might be something that conflicts maybe with a parent, what a parent may say or do. Does anybody remember the context of that?
Yeah, I said they got to honor and respect.
And Matt's going to get back up here and talk, and so he can answer that in a moment. Can you hold on to that?
That's in the context of just what you're talking about right
okay.
now.
Okay, Matt, you want to come up here and...
Yeah. So
there's going to be questions that are going to come up that the parents are actually teaching that they feel is biblical.
Correct.
And their context is different than maybe what mine is and yours is. So what is...
Yeah, and so I wasn't saying that you have to agree with the parent.
Yeah.
You have to honor and respect the parent.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean you can't disagree.
Okay.
And you can tell your student that. I mean, that's okay.
Okay.
You can be like, look, I know mom and dad are saying that you can be born gay. I disagree. That's not what I see in Scripture. Lay out your case.
Okay.
Honor the parent, respect the parent, but also say there's other ways to look at this biblically.
What Matt said there is key. That's not what's said in Scripture. We need, and I'm going to talk about this in just a couple minutes, but we have got to have a biblical worldview. When others are looking and they have a cultural worldview, we need to be different, guys. We need to have a biblical worldview and be ready to back up our claim in Scripture, especially as a student gets older. They need backup to what we are saying. So yeah, so we can disagree with parents, respectfully disagree, as long as we have a biblical basis for what we're saying, and it's not taken out of context. So does that answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks.
All right, so we need to be ready for them to be themselves. We need to be ready for them to share their doubts. We need to be ready for them to ask questions. How do dinosaurs fit in the creation story? You know, be ready for that kind of question. Admit struggles, they're going to do it. They're going to admit their struggles. Like, will my Buddhist friend go to heaven? They're going to ask things like that. How far is too far? They're going to ask questions like that. Am I supposed to be a Republican? They're going to ask things, and we need to be ready to answer their question. A great app for you to download is this. Got questions. Man, got questions. Got questions, and then there's a question mark at the end. So it's got questions and then a question mark. Download that app and study it, because it's got insightful questions, and every question is answered with a biblical answer. It's solid.
Nobody gets afraid. When you say be prepared for the questions, that doesn't mean you have to have every answer.
Yeah.
I mean, there's still stuff that we struggle with that we don't know the answers to, and that we got to get into the honesty part of it. But that's opportunity to say, why don't we sit down sometime and let's study Scripture and find out together what it is. I mean, it's opportunity, and they see that as humility on our part. We don't know it all.
Right.
Scripture doesn't even lay it all out. I mean, we argue among ourselves about what's right and what's wrong. So we can't expect to know every answer, but we have to have an answer. In other words, you know, let's find it. Or I have researched that and I still can't find it.
Or let me get back to you on that. I'm going to study up on that. Let's talk about that next week. And then study up on it.
And ask them to do it too.
Work to find the answer. But you're right. We're not going to have all the answers, and that's okay. But we need to be ready for their questions, because it's coming. Those questions are coming.
It's a very good position to be in, whether you had the answer or not, to not have it and not present it to them at that time. To use that as a time for you to go, that's a great question. Let's talk about that. Let's go into a week of that deal. I agree with that. Great. Yeah.
But humility and honesty in that case are, again, the two
absolutely
big ones that we want them to see.
Matt's going to finish us up. He's going to talk about some last minute details.
So Becky was going to talk at each session. She would kind of go to some logistics and some administration stuff, the stuff that she's gifted at, and it all just keeps us in mind. So we decided that I would try to do this.
The model of administration, Matt B.
Right. The main thing we want you to understand is, if there is anything alarming, any successes that are going on in your groups, any wins, anybody's missing an action, let us know. Let John and I know. We want to be praying for you guys. And the more specifically we can pray. Now, again, it's that discernment you guys have to have between confidentiality, what needs to stay in the group that we don't need to know about,
and what you feel like would be safe and good for us to be praying with you about or celebrating with you about. If you guys get schedules, I would ask for all of your students to get their schedules. Hey, probably talk to their parents. I found that talking to the students saying getting your schedule does not work. Talk to the parent. The parent has a schedule of every baseball game, of every basketball game, of every cheer contest. Ask for a schedule. Now, a lot of stuff I know nowadays is like in Muncie and Bloomington and Cincinnati where you may not be able to go see everything. But for the home stuff, and it's close and it's cheap, be there for that. And we want to know that. Share that stuff with us because I want to be there too. I won't make that promise, but when I can, I will. Wanted to let you guys know about study options. We've went around and around about this. I want you guys to know, especially middle school groups, Emerge, which was the core, it's now Emerge. It does not follow what John's doing, okay? So one complaint we heard was that, oh, my students are getting hit three times with the same message, and it was over. Okay, valid point, we switch. Emerge does something totally different. And so for the first half an hour, it's just social games. Again, back to what phase they're in, the fifth through eighth graders. They don't need another hour study on Sunday morning. And so we let them play, and we let them have fun. And we try to teach during that, and they get in fights. And then Leanne, Jerry, and Debbie do an awesome job leading a half an hour discussion, but it's on something totally biblical, but totally random away from the council. So I let you know that because Becky does an exquisite job of taking what John talks about in the morning and going a totally, usually different direction with it, but still allows them to process what happened that morning. Because there's no feedback on Sunday morning. It's John talking to everyone, or Colin Giebler tomorrow talking to everyone. And there's no time to discuss, well, what'd you think about that? And so I really, really encourage you to use Becky's stuff because it's phenomenal. But if you don't want to use that, we do make concessions. If you want to do a book study, that has worked really well for many groups. And so the last year's sixth graders, now seventh graders, did that last year and inspired a conference that we're going to be putting on this fall. So, I mean, you can't really argue against that. So, but here's the deal about the book studies. We do ask that you get them approved by John or I, just so we can all stay on the same page together. We want to make sure that we're moving in the same direction.
Can I say something about that too? We give, I don't want to get on the camera here so that the people who aren't here can hear this. We give $100 per life group. And some people have said, well, can that be weighted based upon how many students are in life groups? And we can't do that because of some different varying factors. So we give $100. We used to give $50, and so we've upped it. We upped it last year to $100 per life group. So that can go towards events if you want, or it can go towards a bookstore study like Matt is talking about. And so just talk to us if you want to do a book study, and we'll make that happen.
So also on trips and really for anything. Really make sure that your kids have a medical release file. How you do that is you check with Becky. The infamous green sheets, we've got to fill them out. We've got to have that, not just for insurance, but it's just an overall safety thing. Get them for your new kids especially. All sixth graders need to have one because they don't yet, even if they've been to events. But even seniors, stuff changes. And so, normally, if somebody moves, their first thing is not, oh, I've got to go update the church's medical release form, okay? So help families with that and remind them. Make sure your green sheet's up to date, that we have the right information. There'd be nothing worse than us being in Missouri, taking a kid to a hospital and having out-of-date information on their green file. That would be bad. And so just help us help them. This is a big one. When we, John, Becky, or I, communicate with you, please communicate back with us, okay? That's, I know, I wish we had time to call all of you individually, come over to your house and have supper, but it's just not the world we live in. And so we send out these emails sometimes and we don't hear anything back. It's like, are you listening? So let us know you're listening. It helps. We're going to work at being good listeners this year, so let's do that. Even if it's just a got it or thanks, it doesn't take 2 seconds to hit reply things or text back things. So let's work on that. I need to work on that as well. And I'll try to do my best and you contact me. And again, just our last thing is, before we do our last video and then hopefully have some question time, stay with it. You guys are making a difference. You guys are making those drops in the pond that become waves. And you don't see the effect of that drop until sometimes you're miles away. And so just stay with it. Know that we're raising adults, not children. But remember, they're not adults yet. And so they're not just like we used to be. At times they may be, and some of the temptations are forever, from Bible times to today. But remember that these students are facing them in a new context, and younger and younger and younger, we're seeing these temptations coming to them. And so we remember that the principles that got us through some of this stuff is going to be timeless. But the application of those principles is going to be unique to each phase, each group. And again, just remember we're raising adults, and our goal is to move them on for what's next. And so we're going to watch this last clip.
Before we do that, let's make that the very last thing we do and then okay. Pray. Okay. Let's do some Q&A, some questions that you all have that we can answer. If you've got a question, then chances are that other people either have the same question or would think, oh, that's a great question.
What if somebody shows up that's not on our list? Do we have a paper that we have to fill out? Do we send them to you? Because I know of more than a handful of girls who are not signed up yet that their parents have said, you know, yeah, she's coming. Yeah, she's going to be there. She's excited. And not in the binder.
I would grab the green sheets. Becky's got a stack of them. I think they're outside. Are they outside on the...
Yeah, they're outside. And then you can also go to Walmart.
Because they know where I live. When it starts, they may just show up in my house and not be in my binder.
And you'll be liable. There's each person that's in that group, so you want to make sure that they have.
Now, there's three parts to this question. Three parts to this answer. The first part is that you need to email Becky and update the numbers with her. Okay, so you have an attendance on there. And so you're going to need to go through that, and those are the people on your roster. And so you need to make sure those kids come each week. Becky will send out a reminder for you to record your attendance, and so she'll explain how to go about that in the first email that she sends out. She'll tell you how to do that. But weekly, we want for you to go online just quickly and click the kids who are there, because you'll see the name and then there's a checkbox next to it. So if there are people who are coming to your life group, this is important, who aren't on that list, then update the list by emailing Becky and say, I've also got this person coming and this person coming and this person coming. If there's people on your list who are not coming anymore, they haven't come for 2 years or whatever, I don't know, they didn't come last year, or you contacted them and they said, no, I'm going to Stonestown, I'm involved there, or no, I'm worshiping the devil now and so I'm not going to come anymore, then email Becky and have her take that off her list. And then you'll see updated names there. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but
that's...
Was there supposed to be a list in here?
There's supposed to be a list in there. I think Dave had a list in his.
I had a roster on the attendance sheet, like you said.
Oh, no. It's online.
That's what I asked. Yeah. Was it online?
Yeah, it's online.
Okay. It's online. So you'll get an instruction on how to do that. And then the third answer to that is what Matt said with the green sheet. You can go to walkacross.com and print those out. They don't have to be green. They're just what we print them out in. So go to walkyourcross.com, go to the events tab, and then you can print those out.
Good question.
What else?
Can you encourage kids, students, to invite their friends, or is it kind of a, we're trying to build cohesiveness in this group?
Yes.
That's a double-edged sword, man, because it's like you want cohesiveness, but you also want people to come and experience Christ. So yes, is the best answer. Because I mean, really, Sunday morning is better, but we don't want to dismiss people. We don't want it to be closed life groups.
Our group that don't go to church here, but we have a girl, Savannah Fry, that is an inviter. She invites everybody because they love Savannah.
So there's nothing wrong with.
We've got some girls.
There's nothing wrong with inviting people.
When the new people they come, though, it's a good time to revisit the confidentiality thing, because again, we don't want somebody that we have no connection with coming in and then going back to school and being like, "Oh, get some editor for the weekend. Here's all the news I got." So we have to be careful on that too.
What else? I hope this has been good for you guys and helped you, like we have been talking about, not only in your life group leadership, but in your parenting and in your organizational leadership. I hope this has been, I would feel like this has been valuable. We're going to be emailing out a evaluation form of this. And the reason that we added more scripture to this one was because a couple people said last year that they wished there would have been a little bit more biblical basis to what we say. So we do read those evaluations and we make modifications. We want to tweak everything that we're doing and always be getting better and better. So fill out those evaluation forms and be honest with us. But we're glad that you guys have taken the Saturday out, and we're sorry that we went a little long. But let's watch this video, then we'll pray, and then we'll be finished.
Task for raising adults. Father, we need your help.
Father, we thank you so much for each student that is part of Greenwood Christian Students. And Father, we do not take any of them for granted. Father, we know each one of them is unique. Each one of them is loved deeply, even more deeply than we do, by you. And Father, we pray that this year we would double down our efforts to be an influence for Christ in their lives. They have so many voices. They have so many temptations. They have so many directions that they're being pulled. But Father, help us help them make you a priority in their lives. Father, these phases are not just something to be dismissed. They're something to take advantage of and to work in and through, because that's how you have worked in and through us. So Father, help us to be aware. Help us to be wise. Help us to take advantage of the opportunities you've given us. Father, I cannot thank you enough for my friends and brothers and sisters here, and those who couldn't make it, who are investing every week in our students, shaping the next generation of church leaders, elders, ministers. And Father, we're just so grateful to see the growth in our student ministry. We're grateful to see the maturity of our graduates. I'm so excited to see where they're going. And Father, it's hard for us to send them on. It's hard for us to watch them move away to college and start a life and may not come back to Greenwood. But Father, if we've done our job, we know that they are going to be in you, and we know that we will see them again. And so, Father, encourage us this year. Help us to lean on each other as a team. Help us to equip each other as a team. And most of all, Father, help us to lean on you and your Holy Spirit as we go forward. Father, again, I just thank you for this day we've had. Thank you for the time we've had, these facilities. Father, I pray your blessing on our travels as we go to our different places now. Father, help us to take something from the day and apply it. And may your kingdom grow because we were faithful to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.